Ladies and gentlemen, a new presentation on aviation policy. The climate disaster is happening under our eyes. We need to act, and we need to act now. And if in the Netherlands we are in trouble and don't know what to do, we refer to Johan Cruyff, for most of you known as a famous football player, but in the Netherlands especially known as our national philosopher. In this presentation we will give you an analysis as Johan Cruyff would have done. The picture shows you our Secretary of Infrastructure and Water State, as we call it in the Netherlands. And you see her in a typical frame in between airplanes, and that's what she likes. She likes a lot of air traffic. And together with her colleague of finance, she invested 4.7 billion of state aid into the survival of Air France KLM. So what do we know about air traffic and its impact? We know now from a recent report of the Panel of Climate Change that the warming up of the climate has reached a tipping point, which means that it's almost irreversible. We are beyond the point that we can reduce the increase of temperature, which means that whatever we think about this, we need to act swiftly, and we need to act now. And that means a reduction of emissions, also by the aviation sector. And the EU is a bit ambivalent, two-faced about the aviation policy. On the one hand, they say that airports are essential to economic recovery and social cohesion, and they approve state aid to private airline carriers. But on the other hand, there is the Green Deal from the Commission, and these two approaches need to be decided in favor of the Green Deal, whereby the Green Deal might be even a little bit greener than suggested at present. So the end result in the Netherlands is that there is an aviation bill which describes the future of aviation in the Netherlands until 2050, of which the heart of the matter, the core, is that there should be more room available for more flights under the conditions which are mentioned here. The details of this philosophy we discussed in a previous presentation. Please subscribe to this video channel. So here we see Johan Cruyff, you all know as a football player, but as I said, we know as a philosopher. And this is in Dutch, je gaat het pas zien als je het door hebt. And that's untranslatable. You cannot translate Johan Cruyff. But what he is saying basically, but it's more impressive when you say it in Dutch, that you only see connections, you only see relations, what you're seeing. And what you see in these two pictures here is our national airport, Schiphol. And you see the air traffic moving into Amsterdam. And on the right, you see fumes of smoke. And Johan Cruyff immediately sees the connection between the two. They look alike. Like the knowledge we have on emission of CO2 and the climate, we have a lot of knowledge on smoking and its effects. And it's almost shocking to see that we know about the relation between smoking and lung cancer since the 1950s, since 1950 exactly. So for more than 70 years, we have known that smoking is causally related to lung carcinoma. And in 1954, the two authors of the first paper, Richard Doll and Austin Bradford Hill, looked in a large cohort of medical doctors, British medical doctors obviously, about their mortality. And yes, indeed, there was a clear-cut relation between smoking and mortality. So we know since 54 that smoking kills. And to make the circle round, Richard Doll, which was a young man at the time, as a retired professor, he went back to his original cohort and published exactly 50 years later, so half a century later, in the British Medical Journal, the mortality after 50 years of observations in these British medical doctors, confirming the facts we've known for now over 70 years. Once it was known that smoking causes lung cancer, you would expect that a government would act upon this, by trying to get rid of smoking in society. That's not what happened. So what they did in the Netherlands, and I call it occupational therapy, is get all people together on a round table. So doctors, lung doctors, oncologists, patients, tobacco industry, to talk about how you would reach a future where people would not smoke anymore. Stivoro. Meanwhile, it says here in Dutch, our Secretary of Health, even in 2012, was only talking to the tobacco industry. The tobacco industry had a fabulous lobby towards the minister. And even in 2012, she said that smoking was your own private choice. You did not need to smoke. It was the person who decided whether to smoke or not, completely ignoring the fact that the industry deliberately put addictive substances in the cigarettes to make these potential smokers addicted to smoking. Internationally, the lobby of the tobacco industry is even more sinister. So there was probably still is, a foundation for a smoke-free world. Well, that's of course a great foundation. We should all support this foundation. But the truth is, and this is from a recent paper in The Lancet, one of the most authoritative medical journals in Europe at least, The Lancet discovered that this foundation was funded by Philip Morris, one of the most important tobacco industries. For years, the tobacco industry has used the Marlboro Man as a prototype to seduce young people to smoke. Everybody wants to imitate a Marlboro Man. Everybody wants to be a Marlboro Man. So smoking was a must for young men and later also for young women. And on the right side, you see how this Marlboro Man died. He died from terrible lung cancer, just like Johan Cruyff did, by the way. So this says it all. So the conclusion is, if you do a Cruyffian analysis and if you see the parallel between smoking and the reaction of government to not reduce smoking in society with aviation and not trying to reduce aviation nowadays, then we can only say that pleading today, with the knowledge we have now, that pleading for aviation growth is a direct attack on human rights and it should be stopped immediately. Thank you.